Thanks again for inviting me for this this talk. This is a great opportunity, and I see a few familiar faces, and this is also great. Okay, so thanks for introducing me. So I'd like to talk about this economics of market design. So this market design is branch of economics, pretty new one. It's application of microeconomic theory and game theory. Okay, as applied to a very bunch of very specific questions that you might wanna solve in the real life environment. Okay, so because we are in New York City, so I'd like to talk a lot about what happened recently in New York City. Okay, but before that, let me briefly talk about what is market design, okay? Indeed, so the backbone or theoretical background of the market design is the so-called theory of matching. So some of you may have heard of it before. Has anybody have heard of the theory of matching? Okay, I see one hand, I think. Is that a yes or no?
Half
and half. Okay, great. That's great. Okay. So matching. Okay. So I will explain a little bit of the matching, and it's a question of how to match men and women, school and students, and farm and workers and so on. So the economists are interested in how to make a match in such a way that as many people, participants as possible, are as happy as possible. Okay, subject to, of course, all sorts of considerations like, whether nobody wants to break the law or something like that. Okay, I'll talk a little bit about that along the way. So let me summarize though what the market design is. Okay, so I think that basically you have taken some classes in economics, right? And thanks. The answer is yes. Thanks. Most of the things you learned perhaps is the study of how the economy works, right? So take the question of supply and demand, for example. So the presumption is that there is something called the market, okay, and there's something called price somehow, and given price, everybody is selling or buying to benefit most from the price system, and the price adjusts somehow magically to clear demand and supply. Okay, but most of you already know, the world doesn't really work that way, right? Sometimes there are some frictions. You might be very tired. You don't want to think about how much milk to buy today, and so on and so on. And farms have all sorts of considerations. So the market may not be really, really perfectly competitive, and so on and so on. So once we think about that kind of small details, actually, the market, how the market works is pretty delicate, much more subtle than what you might think of abstract view of the market from the old kind of economics. Okay, so, and game theory has been doing a lot of work to actually trying to understand what the very specific features of markets. So some of you might have seen the Kuhn competition, for example, from your microeconomics class, and in that kind of world, there are imperfectly competitive big firms trying to decide what the pricing is, and so on and so on. So, at least 30 years or 40 years, depending on what you think about is the most important advancement in game theory or its application to economics. The great news is that at least for the past 10 years or so, okay, the game theory evolved into a very interesting subfield of market design. Okay, the idea is to use this theory and the tools of game theory to actually not only study the economy as it is, but also actually, you know, design the marketplace, okay? So I said that the real market rules may be very delicate and there are a lot of features, okay, that may not be as simple or smooth as in the competitive market. But then, now you think about it, then actually, you know, if we understand how people might behave in a given environment, then you could actually design the market rule, okay? That could be law, that could be some kind of rules, okay? To actually make people as happy as possible, okay? So I just list a few examples here. So there have been some works on the labor matching markets. So the market designer tries to match workers and firms in such a way that as many workers as possible can find a job and so on and so on. Okay, and there's recent interesting development in the design of organ donation network. Okay, and so on and so on. Okay, but there are too many interesting things. That I cannot really talk about everything in this list here. So let me talk about a very specific thing, okay? So school choice. So so does everybody know what school choice is?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Okay, school choice. So actually this is kind of new thing to me, actually, because when I was a kid in Japan, you know, there was no such thing as school choice. Basically, if you are a kid, you are automatically sent to your neighborhood school, right? But as you all know, relatively recently, there are lots of argument and actually implementation of the school choice. So school choice is the idea that kids and their parents can express preferences, okay, on which school they want to attend. And the school district tries to accommodate such bill, okay, as much as possible, okay. But of course, this idea sounds really, really like a simple thing, right? So given that, you know, the education is to help kids, you know, why don't you just let kids to choose whichever school they want to go to? So very simple, natural, except this is a very difficult problem, actually. Because, you know, simply there are not as many schools or school seats available to accommodate everybody's will, okay, everybody's preferences. So, inevitably, the public school districts need to do some kind of rationing, okay? So some kids can get in and some kids cannot, right? So you might have heard a lot of stories about, you know, places like KIPP or, you know, other kinds of charter schools. So maybe you might have seen this Waiting for Superman, right? The very famous movie. So kids apply, but only a tenth, let's say, of kids can get in, and the remaining 90% of the students are very unhappy and so on. So given that this limit exists, the school districts needs to, you know, make the match as good as possible in certain sense, right? Subject to the constraint of the seats, okay? So one thing you might think about as an economist, you know, is that we want the placement to be as efficient as possible, okay? I.e., well, for example, if, you know, there are seats remaining, okay, unassigned, while some kids are denied the admission, so that certainly is a waste of the available seats. So we want to eliminate that kind of unhappy outcome. And there are of course other cases as well. So if I'm in school A and if you are in school B, and actually I like school B better than school A, and you like school B better than school A, then, you know, obviously that sounds like a bad outcome as well, and so on and so on. So there are lots of considerations I wrote here. So because this is a public school choice system, you might want the placement to be as fair as possible, okay, in a certain sense, which I will actually talk about today. And also, it turns out to be pretty important for the participants to understand the system, okay. So there has been a lot of complaints about certain school choice system in the country, that system was so complicated, opaque, and so on and so on, that some students, kids, and their parents are punished by not really understanding how the system works. So, because, you know, typically, at least in many places in the US, the public school systems have a lot of disadvantaged kids, I mean kids from disadvantaged backgrounds, you know, they typically don't have a lot of resources to really understand and navigate a complicated system, so we want to make the system as clean as possible and easy to participate as possible. So, let's talk a little bit about New York City, okay? So, is anybody from New York City as a kid? Okay, so so now I'm getting nervous because if I make like incorrect statements, so you should correct me. So this system of New York City's public school, okay, it turns out that the system that was present in place until mid-2000s didn't really deliver the kind of desiderata that I just listed. Okay, so let me talk about the system, roughly speaking. So there are many kids, okay, first of all. So this is the biggest, public school system in the country. So in the mid-2000s, there were just a little bit over 90,000 students, okay, in 1 year. So this is for, high school level, okay. So the schools needs to decide how this 90,000 students should be allocated to different schools. Obviously, it's going to be a really complicated problem because there are so many students, right? So, what was the system? Well, not that great. This was the old system. First of all, each student submits a list of schools, okay? So at before the system was changed, it was 5 schools. So basically you list 5 schools you are interested in and send out the application, okay? And then each school looks at the list of students who sent in these applications, right? And then school makes a decision as to who should be given the offer, okay? And this is done independently. So the system was pretty much decentralized, okay? And then, obviously, because different schools make offers independently from other schools, some kids get a lot of multiple offers, right? While some kids don't get into any of the schools, okay? So what happened to these students who don't get into any of their preferred schools? Well, there is a waiting list, okay? So some kids are put on the waiting list, and then when some kids decide to accept an offer from one school among many schools, then other schools' seats are vacated, okay? Opens up, and then the wait list can be processed. But this system didn't quite really work, okay? Why? Well, first of all, obviously, there are a lot of people on the waiting list, and in the system in the 2000s, there was only 3 rounds of application and processing of these applications, okay? That means, well, you know, there are 90,000 students and more than 500 schools doing this, complicated and time-consuming process, and there was simply not too much time, enough time to process all possible preferences of students. Okay? So, not surprisingly, a lot of kids didn't get into any of the good schools. Okay? So, out of 90,000 students, there were as many as 30,000 students who didn't even get into any of the choices that the student listed. Okay? So this is a big number, right? So there are like more than one third, I think. Okay, one third of students didn't get into any of the choices. So that sounds like a problem. Okay, so obviously this looks like a problem. And if I can use just one word, the problem of the New York City seems to be the congestion. Okay, the process was congested in the sense that not all preferences are processed. Okay, and as a result, you know, many kids didn't get into any of the good places. So because of these considerations, you know, the Department of Education in New York City thought about a good idea. Instead, let's use certain kind of centralized clearinghouse, okay? Clearinghouse, I guess you're familiar with the clearinghouse. So somebody's, some match organizer exists, and every participant in the market, in this case the school districts, right, submit preferences, okay? Students submit preferences to the clearinghouse, okay? In this case, DOE, right? And schools also, in this case, principals submit preferences over students and how many seats are available. Okay, given all this information, what the Department of Education can do is, as a clearinghouse, is that they run a computer algorithm to decide the final allocation. Okay, so using the computer and given all the information about the preferences of everybody, okay, then the certain computer algorithm will be used, okay, to place students to some schools one by one, okay, for each of the 90,000 students. Sounds like a pretty cool idea, I guess. Except. It's not clear from just writing this way what kind of algorithm we should use. Okay, so you know, as I said, the typical situation that might happen is, well, you know, lots of students might like a particular school, and obviously there are not enough seats to satisfy everybody's preferences. Okay, so somehow one student should be rejected over another. Okay, but then it's not just a simple matter of lottery, actually, right? Because if a student is rejected from one of the top choices, that rejected student should still be allocated somewhere. Okay, so somehow we should actually decide the complete rule as to who or what happened to these rejected students as well. That's very nice. Not in the system I will talk about today, and typically no.
Okay.
That's a very good question. So I think your question is, so basically, as I said, in the clearinghouses, we will see students submit the first choice school, second choice school, and so on and so on, but they don't say how much he or she likes the first choice better than second choice. So that is actually one potential concern for the existing system, actually. So actually, Professor Yonkou Che here has a paper on this, so pointing out that some of the mechanisms, including those used in New York City currently, actually, might miss some of the UTD, okay, the efficiency gain, the welfare gain, because they only ask rankings. Mm-hmm. So let me actually come back, try to come back to that topic after I actually presented what's happening now, okay. But that's a very good point. Okay. So it turns out that other school districts often use certain kind of clearinghouses, and they have pretty much, you know, a concrete description of how the algorithm works. Okay, and Boston is a very well documented example. So let me talk about this city. Okay. Actually, this rule, this assignment system, is now called the Boston mechanism. Obviously, because it was used in Boston. Although actually, in the city of Boston, it's not used anymore. It is two economists who wrote this paper on the school choice, and they named the mechanism Boston mechanism. But then the Boston mechanism changed this name. So it's kind of misnomer now, but unfortunately, we are still using this name. And every time we talk about this mechanism, we should actually apologize to the Boston cities, because actually, well, many economists actually don't like this mechanism and tend to write a paper criticizing this mechanism. But anyway. Okay, so let me show how this mechanism works, okay? So this is a mechanism used in Boston up until 2005. Okay, here's a computer algorithm. In the first step, the first choices are considered, okay? The computer looks at all the first choices of each student, okay? And then, imagine that the computer let students to apply to these first choices. Okay, so if I list school A as a first choice, virtually I am applying to school A now. Okay, then what happens? Well, if let's say I am the only guy applying to school A and there are seats remaining in seats in A, then I'll get admitted. Okay, and as long as there are seats to allocate to students, i.e. more seats are available than the number of students, then these students are admitted. Okay, but if there are more students applying, okay, to the school, okay, than the seats available, then the lowest ranking students among these applicants will be rejected. Okay, so and if you have 50 seats in the school and there are 60 students, then the bottom 10 will be rejected. Okay. So now, as promised, I should talk about what happened to these guys who are rejected. In the step two, now all the seats assigned in step one is gone. So we think of a smaller problem. Okay. So the seats that have not been allocated in the first step is to be allocated in this step, okay? And in step two, students whose first choices were not granted apply to their second choices, okay? Of course, I mean the computer lets virtually students to apply to the second choices. Now, what happens? Well, very similar procedure is repeated basically, but with the remaining seats, okay? I.e., so if in a particular school, let's say A, 50 out of 100 seats have been already allocated to the students who listed the school as the first choices, then the people who apply in this step compete for the remaining 50 seats, okay? And similarly, top students are accepted, and bottom students in excess of the remaining seats will be rejected, and they apply to the third choices, and so on and so on. Okay. So if I apply to my first choice and I get accepted, then I will not apply to anything else. So it used to be the case that in Boston, the number was restricted to 5. Okay, I believe it was 5, but I don't remember it correctly, 100% sure actually. So actually that's one of the fine points I did not talk about, but it also became a policy issue in places like Boston, New York actually. So now, among other things, the Boston actually allows students to list as many schools as you want. And the obvious reason is that, you know, if the list is too short, then it's really unlikely that the students' wills are granted. So let's say every student likes a particular school best, and particular school B second, and so on and so on. Then what happens is basically it's really just a lottery system. So what happens is the best student will be in the first school, and the second best student will be in the second school, and so on and so on. Mm-hmm. So it would most likely predict a very big stratification. So fortunately, this didn't happen. I mean, there's at least no evidence that this is happening because of this kind of algorithm. Because typically in public schools, there are at least certain heterogeneity, both in student preferences and also in school preferences. Okay, so students typically care about how good the school is, but also they care about how far away the school is. Okay. Of course, there are a lot of other considerations, such as strengths in a certain subject and so on. So in such a case, this algorithm becomes much more interesting. Usually, the students care about how good the academics is in the school. As I said, vicinity. Also, oftentimes, which I am not talking explicitly here, is, you know, whether if you're a minority student, whether there are enough people of the same ethnicity so that they have good social life and so on. So these things are typical considerations. So for here, the presumption though is that students. Preferences are pretty much free. The idea is that economists are still not being able to pin down exactly, you know, what the student preference is exactly. So in such a case, what the economists typically think is, okay, so we don't know what the preference is. Okay, so. Some students might like a good academics, some students might like a beautiful building. So in the absence of the information for the designer's part, then it is probably a good idea to let the students themselves to choose. So that's the kind of background idea behind this. Except, I will criticize this algorithm for the following reason. Okay. So this mechanism, Boston mechanism, has a big problem. And one of the biggest problems, actually there are many, but one of the biggest problems is that it's strategically manipulable, okay? Strategically manipulable, meaning that if you're a kid or a parent, telling the truth about your preferences is not necessarily a good thing to do, okay? And hence, the honest people are punished, okay? Honest is a little bit of a weird word to use from an economist, I guess. But what I actually mean is, well, let's imagine a city like New York City, okay? There are some kids in the middle class and some kids whose background is pretty bad, okay? kids in this neighborhood, okay, there's a concern that these kids don't have really a lot of information about the school system, or they may not have a lot of resources to spend so much time and effort to actually understand how best to navigate this system, right? So in such a case, if the mechanism is such that it's telling the truth about the preferences is not it's not a good thing, then there's a concern that these disadvantaged students may be further disadvantaged because of the system. Okay, and of course, if you know preferences are somehow not true preferences, okay, submitted preferences are not true preferences, then you know this whole idea of trying to accommodate fast choices doesn't make too much sense, right? And so I'm not sure if. Okay, so I'm not sure if this is like surprising or not, but let me make sure that we understand why this Boston mechanism is obviously manipulable. Okay, why is that? Actually, a newspaper tells you. Okay, the newspaper says the following advice to students. Okay, it says make a realistic informed selection on the school you list as your first choice. And why is that? This is because if the computer selection rejects your first choice, then your chances of getting your second choice school are greatly diminished. Okay? And you might go down in the line and get fourth, fifth, or sixth choice. Okay? And why is that? Well, you know, because the Boston mechanism first processes first choices, right? And then that means if your first choice school happens to be a very popular school, then if you get rejected from that school, then and then if you are applying to your second choice in the second round, then chances are that these seats in the second choices are already gone as well. So if you are, unless you are really really sure that you can get into your true first choice, you know, you might actually hesitate to list your first choice, right? Instead, you might actually list your second choice as a reported first choice. So imagine that you actually have the first choice, school A as a first choice and B as a second choice. Let's say I'm so concerned that both A and B might be gone when I apply. Okay, then I might list B as a first choice and just not listing A. So what could happen because of that kind of change of my submitted preferences once actually the algorithm is run, then it could happen that actually A has not actually been demanded as much as I thought. So that makes me very very unhappy, and it's a social waste because you know actually if the school districts were able to get your true preferences, which is A is the first choice, then you know they could have actually placed you into your true first choice. So in that sense, this feature actually can result in an actual waste. So this is the problem listed in this newspaper. Actually, the city government even knew that. So even though they didn't think really about how to fix it, so instead what they said is, for a better choice of your first choice school, consider choosing less popular schools. So they understood how this mechanism works, and they just didn't think about, well, okay, then why don't we actually change the algorithm, okay? So now this seems like a potential problem. So what is the fix of this, right? So this is actually what we, New York City did, as well as actually Boston. Okay, so they worked with economists and game theorists, okay, and introduced different kinds of algorithm. Okay, so this is called the student proposing deferred acceptance algorithm. So this is actually a very old mechanism, proposed by Gale and Shapley, 50 years ago. Okay. And this is actually used in medical match in the US and in other countries. And that makes actually pretty much good sense. So here is a description of the algorithm. Looking a little bit complicated, but this is very similar to Boston. Okay, first choices are pretty much the same as Boston. Okay, each student applies to her first choice, and schools look at all the applicants and reject everybody above and beyond the number of seats. Okay, but for the remaining students, the school does not actually accept these students, and instead they just tentatively hold these students. Okay, what does that mean? That means in the second choices, these students could be rejected in the following way. Okay, here is the second choice. Students who are rejected from the first choice apply to their second choices here. Okay, then each school considers both those who were tentatively kept in the first choice, okay, and the new applicant. Okay, and then look at the combined pool of this total pool of applicants, and then choose the best ranking students and reject everybody else. So the key here is that, unlike in the Boston mechanism, the acceptance is only tentative. So even if a student is tentatively accepted in the first choice by a school, if somebody with a higher ranking to the school applies in the second choice, okay, then the first student may be actually rejected in the second choice, second step, okay. And similarly, the algorithm works like that to the third step, fourth step, and so on, and until everybody is placed somewhere, okay. Or maybe unmatched. Okay. So I guess the name, the default acceptance, is probably very clear now, right? So that the defining feature of this algorithm is that the acceptance is deferred, okay, not finalized in any step of the algorithm until the end. So this looks like a pretty small difference, right? So the only difference is that whether the application is immediate, acceptance is immediate or tentative. Okay, yeah, so first of all, let me clarify how the algorithm works. So let's say I'm tentatively accepted in the first choice, right. First step, and then somebody else comes in the second choice and I get rejected. Right. Then in the next step, I apply again to my second choice. Uh-huh. So even if I'm rejected from my first choice, in the later step, I still have a chance. Remember, we are talking about a clearinghouse, so basically students actually prepare a list of schools from top, second, and so on, and then apply it, and that's the only thing that the students should do. Okay. So actually, there's no extra cost of being rejected.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks. That's a good clarification. So both in the Boston mechanism and in this deferred acceptance algorithm, everybody simply submits the rank order list, and then the only difference is basically how the computer program is written, actually. And by the way, for that precise reason, I mean, part of the reason is this one, I think. And because of this reason, I think, this change seems to be such a small point, and actually, probably for that reason, most of the education literature didn't even think about this subtle differences until actually economists began talking about this. And actually, in one of the documents in the study by the education field in the 1990s, actually, the school choice using Boston mechanism was touted as such a big success because so many students were placed in their first choice schools. Okay, but you know, we shouldn't believe that necessarily, right? Because you know, precisely because Boston mechanism, you know, makes students play very safe. So you know, chances are that the stated first choice, okay, as appearing in data, may not be their real first choice. Okay, so, but of course, you know, it's not clear that this strategic manipulation is the only thing that the schools should care about, right? And actually, one of the big motivation for this change, another motivation actually, is that arguably, people think that the deferred acceptance algorithm makes a more fair assignment than the Boston mechanism. Okay, so let me explain what this means. Okay, so this fairness notion is formalized by academics as the concept of stability. Okay, don't worry why it's called stability. Okay, for now. So the idea is that there may be some envy because I might get into school A, my first choice school, and you may not get into the same school, even though you might also like that school. So there may be a very unfortunate case where somebody has an envy to somebody else, but at least we want there to be no justified envy. What does that mean? We want there to be no situation in which a student, let's say, let's call them A. Okay, so I use A as a school, I think. Anyway, the student is matched to a school worse than certain school, okay, and somebody else is matched to that school, okay, school S, let's say. But that guy who is placed in my favorite school has a lower priority than I have. So in such a case, I'm not only unhappy, but also justifiably unhappy. Because, you know, I can always say to the, I mean, I will likely to say, complain to the Department of Education saying, well, you know, I didn't get into the school I like, and somebody else is in the school, and actually I'm more prepared, right? So in such a case, it's deemed to be very unfair, okay? So in the sense, there should be some reason. Whenever I'm not accepted to a school, there should be some justifiable reason. This is based on the preferences of students and the preferences of school principals. So what I mean is, whenever I complain to the Department of Education, I like school A better than B, I didn't get into A. Why? then the Department of Education should say, sorry, okay, we are sorry you didn't get in, but that's because there are some other students who are liked better by the school. So this is almost the only thing I want to say, and so I can actually go on to the proof, actually. So do you want to see it or not? Okay, good. Actually, this is a great stuff, because actually this is a very good proof, but we don't need any math, I mean. Okay, so it's very cool. Okay, so I claim that the outcome of the deferred acceptance is stable, i.e. No justified NB. Why? Suppose that the student, let's call him A, okay, likes the school S better than her assignment, okay, under the algorithm, then we'd like to show that this seat in school S is taken by somebody, okay, with higher priority, who is liked more by, preferred by school S, okay? Okay, what does that mean that school, student A is not assigned to her more preferred choice? Well, that means in the deferred acceptance algorithm, because people apply from the top and apply down, so the student A applied to school S and then get rejected at some point of the algorithm, okay? But then that means that at the point when she applied to the school seats are already taken by students more preferred by the school, right? That is the only way that she can be rejected, right? Okay, so this is, by the way, very different from Boston, because in Boston mechanism, okay, you know, even if you have a very, very high priority in the school, if you apply very late in the steps, then lower ranking people might have already taken up all the seats, right? So this does not happen in DA. So in DA, well, seats are already taken by even more preferred students, and after that, the school gets more and more application as the steps goes on. So the assignment for school gets only better along the way. So this step 3 and 4 means that in the end of the algorithm itself, the school is matched with students who are better, I mean, more preferred than the student A. Okay. So for that reason, what does it mean? Okay, so to summarize, okay, so I like school S better than what I got in the end. Okay, so why am I not getting it? Well, that is because you have already applied to that preferred school in some step of the algorithm, right? And then you got rejected. And you got rejected by the fact that there are even better candidates to the school. And that means that your envy is not justified. Students don't tell the true preferences, then the stability, which I just showed, may not make sense. Yeah. The good thing, though, is that we have actually noticed that in DA, that it is strategy proof for students. So this is another reason that we the New York City's Department of Education actually liked this this algorithm. Actually, a little bit of aside, there are other algorithms proposed by academics which is strategy proof, but not stable. Okay, so there can be a situation with justifiable NB. And actually, both these algorithms have been considered in New York City's case. But in the end, because of this concern for fairness, the Department of Education actually adopted this algorithm. So if you are interested, we can talk about other algorithms, but maybe not before 8. So, okay, so maybe let's skip it, okay? So it turns out that there are a lot of other good properties in the deferred acceptance algorithm. So for that reason, I am working a lot on this particular algorithm, as well as the desirable concepts itself, like strategy proofness and absence of justified envy. So these things turn out to be pretty important for actually trying to designing these school choice algorithms. So let me just mention that this is not just New York City, okay? So, because apparently not everybody is from New York City as a kid, right? Me included. Okay, anybody from Boston by any chance? Boston area? Okay, nobody. Okay, so Boston itself changed the algorithm. Okay, it used to be called the Boston mechanism, used Boston mechanism, but Boston Globe basically wrote an article citing these papers criticizing the Boston mechanism, and apparently the school authority got pretty mad about it, and then they changed it. So Chicago also has had a version of the Boston, but changed to UDA. And Seattle is an interesting case. So Seattle actually came up with a version of the deferred acceptance on their own, but then they changed back the algorithm into Boston recently. So this is actually different from what we actually expected to happen. So that might be actually interesting case study, but let me not talk too much about today. Very different application. So I guess I said this, but so this algorithm consideration has been a big subject in medical match. So medical residency match works like in the school choice, except that here it's really the case that not only doctors but also hospitals have list actually students. Okay, I mean strictly, not using the random lottery. And also in the U.S., there's a national residency matching program that organizes this match. And this organization also uses a version of the deferred acceptance algorithm. And I think as we discussed, I think it when they first made it, they made it in such a way that actually the algorithm is a hospital proposing version. So it seems that they made it by chance, but students found out that actually this was a hospital proposing version. So they pressured the organization to change it to the student proposing version. Okay. So there are a lot of interesting theoretical questions around this, but let me not talk about it, I guess. Okay. And I'm currently working on a theoretical study related to Japanese residency match. Japanese residency match also has some version of the deferred acceptance algorithm. However, they made a little bit of a tweak, which I think is a mistake. It has some efficiency loss because of the change they made, and I'm thinking about how to fix this. So actually Fanji is actually helping me thinking about this. So if you have questions, ask him. So I think you read the paper more recently than I did. So okay. So other applications, not in the U.S. but in places like Hungary and Turkey, so these are the countries where the government tend to have more control, so they can organize a clearing house. So they also use a version of the deferred acceptance algorithm. So in the perfect world, I would guess that there are lots of benefits from moving into this system of clearing houses. So from the school side, a big benefit is that they can safely assume that there are not more enrollments than they can take, right? So you can submit, you know, you have 100 seats, okay? And algorithm never places more than 100 people, okay? So in the decentralized market, like in the U.S. college admission, oftentimes they are overshooting. So certainly there seem to be some benefit. So look, it seems that though that in many places actually this move to the to the clearing house, which I think can be a very good idea, did not happen actually. Perhaps because the coordination among schools may be too difficult. So there are some interesting cases though. So one thing I'm aware of is that in some medical residency, they used to have a system like the U.S. college admission. So they used to do it actually in a decentralized way, but they were pretty unhappy, and they made it into the centralized match. Actually, the NRMP is a big case study of this. So they used to have the residency. Happened in the beginning of the 20th century, and they used to have a decentralized market, but then that made the system so complicated, and so actually these medical people on their own established this clearinghouse. Actually, even before the first paper on this this field actually was written, so there seemed to be actually even. That means even without economists advertising this, okay? so that can be possible. So I would hope to be able to talk about all these different applications, because actually all of these, almost each of these applications, there are actually specific interesting problem that actually motivates thinking about particular questions, but. Probably we shouldn't do it too much, so let's conclude for now, okay? So basically, the message I'd like to deliver today is that, I want you guys to study market design, and the reason is not only that I'd like to have more friends, but also, more importantly, I firmly believe that this kind of like study is so interesting. And interesting, firstly, because and it can use the tool of math. Okay, we actually saw the very elegant proof actually, even within this short amount of time, right? And so it can use a tool of math, so you can actually say something definite, okay, which is very rare for public debate, okay, and not only that, unlike some of the other kind of things, you can show mathematically, actually that is pretty useful in many cases. Okay, maybe I shouldn't do negative advertisement or anything, but what I'd like to say is this is very useful. So we looked at just one case study of school choice, okay, how this theoretical insight actually helped form the specific clearinghouse. Okay, so I think this is very interesting stuff to think about. I mentioned briefly that I'm working on this kind of stuff now, and what I'm working on now is that in school choice, obviously, the important feature of the school choice is that school choice may give a lot of incentives for public schools to improve, right? As it turns out, despite all the good things I said about these studies on market design, little has been studied actually about this particular important aspect of the school choice, i.e. how the school choice mechanism might influence the schools to improve or not improve the quality of education. So we have this paper finding the following. Unfortunately, actually, we found that no reasonable algorithm, okay, actually give a proper incentives for schools necessarily. Okay, not only the Boston, which I criticized today, but also the deferred acceptance algorithm. Okay, so take any well-behaving mechanism. There are situations in which the schools have incentives to actually become bad for some students, and then deflect these students from applying, and then hence get a better set of students, I mean more preferred set of students. So this really perverse incentives can actually not be completely eliminated in any of the mechanisms considered in the past. the fortunate good news though is that we also found other foreign. But the probability, okay, likelihood that this weird thing happening is very small for the deferred acceptance algorithm. And actually, the probability goes to zero in the limit as a school district becomes large enough. Okay? But then, other mechanisms, such as the Boston mechanism, actually even fails this condition, i.e., so the, not only is it theoretically possible that the schools may have a bad incentive to become a bad school for some students, okay, under the Boston mechanism, but also, actually, the likelihood that this unfortunate outcome happens can be pretty high. So, and we also compare other kinds of mechanisms and get similar conclusion. So, this study is still preliminary, so two questions I think we can think about. So first, what if a student is not completely sure about his or her own preferences, but he or she has actually expectation, okay? So, I mean, at the point of allocation, you don't know enough about school A and B, but you know that your expected UTT is that A is higher than B, okay? So if it was the issue, then the theory just works by interpreting that the preferences is just coding the expected UTT. So that was the easy part, okay? The more difficult problem which you raise is what happens if students are really uncertain about don't have even a strict ranking between A and B, even in expectation. Okay, so first thing is that most of the people working in this field believe that this is not a big deal because if you think about, I mean, this is not necessarily a big deal in this particular application, I should be a little clear, because even if the students are not completely sure about the ranking, then as I said, you can still ask the, you know, what is the expectation, and the exactly same UTT is a little bit of a knife edge case. I mean, people think that this is a knife edge case. Exception may be that, I mean, a very likely exception is probably that if you don't think that, you know, school A and B are both bad, if you think that school A and B are both bad, and I don't even care to think about, then it's likely that in your eyes, A and B are exactly the same. But in such a case, we can interpret that these schools are just unacceptable, even worse than, let's say, your neighborhood school, for which you are guaranteed to be able to go. And the theory turns out to actually work, as long as these indifferences are for that schools you don't really like. Okay. And theoretically though, actually, this question of indifferences are very interesting, especially, I mean, has attracted a lot of interest, okay, from economists, from the point of view of the schools. So schools are naturally have indifferences, as we have, I guess, discussed. So in such a case, actually, we need to somehow, you know, operationalize this deferred acceptance algorithm, or maybe think of a completely different algorithm. So that part is still a little bit going on in the current literature, actually. And finally, in the computer science literature, actually, that is a very interesting question, because in the computer science literature, obviously, this deferred acceptance algorithm is very fast, right? You can, you know, at each step, you know, at least one application is made, and so the number of steps you need is bounded by the number of students times the number of schools. So it's very small in computation, for computers. And with indifferences, you should, you know, even if you think of, let's say, if you want to find all stable matchings, for example, then you should, you may be need to think about all possible tie-breaking, okay? And that is computationally too complex. So computer scientists are working a lot on how to actually make it possible. So that to make that long story short, basically there are a lot of interesting stuff around your question. If you read this paper and give comments, I appreciate it. But you don't have to read that particular paper, but I hope that you get interested in this kind of subject. Okay, so that's all for now.